How are we doing it? Whoa, that is amazing. That's what happens when you have four kids and you don't get here early enough for mic check. That's what happens right there. It's really crazy. I step up here just being a middle child, you know? I just want to touch all of Michael's stuff, you know? Just put a bunch of like hymns and stuff up there. Anyways, happy Sunday. Glad to see you all here today. Super, super glad that we're not outside in the sweltering heat, but still just to know that God made today. And the creator of the universe, not only did he make today, he made all of us on purpose, with a purpose, but also that the fact that the creator of the universe who created us is here with us. And that's amazing. There's no barrier. There's no giant curtain. There's no person between us and him. We can have an intimate relationship with the creator of the universe. And I'm going to tackle just a few quick announcements. And then we're going to get into the service as a whole. Part of this relationship that we have with the Creator is through prayer. And the men, there's going to be a men's prayer breakfast Saturday, September 18th at 8 a.m. And all the men are invited. I mean, fathers, you have teenage sons, bring them. Teenage sons, pastor your dad, have him show up. It's an amazing time where we can connect with God. Another one is the following day. If you're here, if you're a newcomer, you want to learn a little bit more about Lighthouse, about the God that we worship, what we stand for, we're going to have a Discover Lighthouse right after service on the 19th. And last thing, if you're looking around, like, we haven't been passing the offering plate, right? I mean, just because of since the pandemic started. But just know if you still desire to worship with giving, there's black boxes at the back. You can see any of the pastors. You can mail it in. You can even give online. You can download the church app, and you can go to mylcc.church as well. And that's if you've missed anything here, or if I rambled a little too fast, or if you didn't write down a date, you can find all the information there. And now we're going to move into a time of worship. Father God, thank you for being here. Thank you for having control in a world that seems out of control, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship you. Amen.
This morning as we worship.
Oh, hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate for. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, he ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial board, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
Amen. Can we just crown him King of Kings this morning? Isn't he Lord of Lords above all things? Can we get excited about that? He is our King. He is risen. He is alive. And he is the reason that we're here this morning. Thank you for some of you getting excited. But as we continue to worship, focus on that. The next song we're going to sing is the gospel. It's the gospel in a song. And as we sing it, reflect on it. Reflect on the words. And reflect on the fact that our King is risen. He is risen indeed.
In the darkness, we will without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin king the world, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Oh, praise the Father.
Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit. Three in one. God of glory, majesty. Praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in our suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died.
Oh, we praise the Father.
Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit. Three in one. God of glory, majesty, and praise forever to the King of Kings. And the morning the heroes all ahead held its breath, till the stone was moved for good, for the Lamb it conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and then the Spirit lit the flame. And now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Pray with me. Father, we thank you for this morning. We are so grateful to be here, God. We thank you that we have this building, that we have air conditioning, that we have seats, that we have sound systems, all these blessings, God, that you have given us in order to use, to focus on, and worship you. And I pray, Lord, that whatever we came into this building with this morning, whatever distractions, whatever worries, even whatever joys, God, that we would just set them aside for a few moments so that we can remember how great, how loving, how forgiving, how powerful you are. We thank you so much, God, for Jesus Christ. We thank you for what he has given us, for the life that he has shared with us,
and for the hope that we have in him. And whatever's going on in the world, good or bad, God, we know that it all culminates in you, and that the world is in your hands, our life is in your hands, and we're okay because of you. So we praise you, God, we thank you, and we ask that you would help us. And Father, as we get ready for this week of many of the kids going back to school, I just want to lift up the students and the teachers and the parents of all those who are returning to the schedule, God. And I just ask you to bless this year for the kids and for everyone involved, Lord. I pray that it would be a great year of learning and education and joy, that there would be an increase not just in knowledge but of wisdom. We thank you that your word tells us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And I pray that that students would honor you by how they learn, how they interact with their teachers, and how they interact with each other. And would you please bless Lighthouse as we prepare for the fall with kids ministry and student ministry returning, Lord? Would you please bring the right people to volunteer and to help and to serve our kids? Would you also just create excitement? And would you help us accomplish our mission, which is to truly help students understand who you are and to dedicate their lives to you. You are worth that, and you're worth our effort in helping that to become a reality. So, God, we just lift up your name. We thank you for this morning, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Church, we're going to learn one new hymn together. New for some of us, old for others. But it's a beautiful hymn. It's from the Psalms, and it just sings, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name." Let's sing it together.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name.
That's simple enough, right? Let's sing it again together.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Sing, he has done great things, and he has done great things.
The Lord.
Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name.
You guys sound beautiful.
Well, good morning, church. For those of you who don't know, I am not Pastor Doug. I am Rick George. I'm the administrative pastor here, and I'm excited, as always, to be able to share with you guys what God has been speaking and building this message with, and I'm excited for this time, although I do want to take a moment and acknowledge that, you know, we're coming to the end of our summer psalm series for the summer, and kind of today is the last official day of summer for the George family. My four kids go back to school tomorrow, and they're super excited to get up early and get going and have a great day of learning. So today kind of marks the end of it, and part of me is completely okay with that, because I'm going to go on a little rant here for a moment. My kids have been driving me nuts. So there's two things that my kids have been doing that's just been irritating me, and I'm just going to spend a minute just to get it off my chest, because the last two times I've come up here and spoke, I've told you that this was my therapy session, so we're just going to keep that rolling. So we didn't go and do any, like, trip or anything this year because we're building a house, so we've been spending our time doing that, but my kids have gone on lots of adventures. You know, they've gone to camp, and they've done missions trips, and they've hung out with cousins, and they've hung out with friends, and they've been doing all of these different things, and every time they go to do these different things, I'm, like, handing out money, you know, and it just keeps going, and then they come back, and I'm like, hey, did you have a good time? And they're like, yeah. I'm like, okay, well, what was your favorite part? The whole thing. Like, the whole thing was your favorite part? Yeah. Like, well, do you want to do it again next year? Yeah. Well, why? It was good. It's like, these are the answers I'm getting. Like, okay, was there a moment where, like, on the missions trip or at camp that God was like, hey, I wanted to meet you here and I wanted to tell you this? And they're like, probably. You know, it's just like, I am, like, dishing out money and these are the answers I'm getting. And it's a little frustrating. And then when they're not, like, costing me money to give me very little details, they're, like, on their tablets and phones, and they're watching videos. And the things about these videos with, like, YouTube and TikTok is often it's highlights to life. And they're watching these highlights, and they're not actually experiencing the entire journey of the event. So they watch other people, like, show highlights of the video game they're playing. And I'm like, just play the game then. Like, experience the frustration of Mario continually falling off the cliff. But they watch the end, and they'll watch highlights of, like, athletic events. And it's like, no, the whole game adds context to why that moment is so great. You know, football is 3 yards in a cloud of dust that sets up this amazing play. And so they're just missing all these things so they can go back to school and learn, because they're bothering me. So anyway, my rant is over. So we are in the Summer Psalm series, and I'm the first two that I did this year, I was sharing with you how in the first one I was missing my joy. And you guys were getting kind of a real-time account of what God was doing in my life as he was restoring my joy. And so we're going to kind of wrap up that thought of joy, and I think that's extremely important. If you went into my office, you'd see I have stacks of books on joy, and I had those well before this summer, because they're finding joy is so important and happiness is so important for people to find success, and so God has been moving in that, and I'm excited to share with you what the Lord has prepared for this morning. But let's go ahead and start with some prayer. Father, we do praise you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your amazing love for us. God, right now, we want to pause and acknowledge you as our maker and our creator and our savior and our God and our Father. And we give you this time as an offering, as an act of worship, acknowledging you as the only one worthy of our praise. Lord, calm our hearts and our minds. Open our ears to hear from you and only you. Lord, if there's anything that I am going to say or that I do say that isn't what you prepared, let it fall on deaf ears. We praise you in advance for what you will do. In your name we pray. Amen. So back in June, I shared with you guys again that I was struggling with my joy and I didn't want to be at church and I was just kind of irritated. And I shared through looking at Psalm 34 that my joy was not founded properly. I had stuck my joy upon my calling in the church, and you can stick it to so many good things that are noble things and righteous things, but if your joy is not founded on God, all of those things can have ebb and flows to them, and they can shift, and they can change, and that causes your joy to move and be difficult to keep. But when you found your joy on God, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is from the beginning of time to the end of time, and God will never move. So when our joy is founded on God, our joy won't be lost. And we saw how David was doing that even in some really crazy situations where he's like, hey, my calling isn't to be king. My calling isn't to be a giant killer. My calling isn't these. My calling is to be a man after God's own heart. And David showed us how to put our joy on a solid foundation. Then a few weeks later in July, I followed that up by saying, hey, this is where God has continued to lead me on this journey for joy. And I had to understand through reading David's Psalms in chapter 30, that understanding God as our Redeemer is important for finding our joy. Because when we understand that God can take moments that sometimes we put ourselves in these desert scenarios or these difficult times, we do that to ourselves, but God can redeem those moments, whether he's teaching us or calling us or shaping us through those, or he's using us in those moments to spread joy and his salvation and his grace and his love to other people. And we can cause those problems by getting away from God's will from us, but God will redeem those moments. And sometimes we're in tough spots because other people made decisions, and God will redeem those. And sometimes you're just in a thing like this COVID season, and God can redeem those and do great things. And we found that a big key to having joy is understanding God is our Redeemer and the Redeemer of all things. And today we're going to kind of wrap this up. And have you ever been to like a seminar and you go, you know, this is great, I've learned all of this stuff, but now I have to go and make it applicable to life? And how do we keep going the information we got from this seminar and we put it out there? So today is, how do we sustain our joy? And how do we keep it going? And you know, there's sometimes that it's absolutely amazing that we'll be working on a message and we won't be talking with Pastor Michael about what the message is. And then we get here and we see the list of the songs and we're like, wow, God like orchestrated that. And it's just amazing. Today that didn't happen. I asked him to play Bless the Lord. So like I knew ahead of time, like, hey, make sure we play this, because bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name, because he has done great things. And that's actually Psalms 103, okay? So we're going to look at Psalms 103 today, and you can see it on the screen. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits. So a little translation, but that's where that comes from. It's right there. We sang it like three different times. It's that scripture right there. Some neat things about this is we will see praise the Lord, which praise the Lord and bless the Lord are the same thing. So if you remember, Pastor Doug has said multiple times, especially when we went through our context series and understanding how to read scripture in context, a Hebrew word is an overstuffed suitcase. That one word can be used a lot of different ways, and you got to look at a lot of things. So the word bless we use is often one of those words where we'll say, oh, I'm blessed. I'm living the blessed life. And we say that, and it's like, okay, God has bestowed a favor, a grace, a mercy on me. And so we use the word bless for that, but we can also say bless the Lord. Now, when we say that, we're not saying, oh, I'm going to bestow a favor to God, because that's not in my smallness. That's not how that works. What I'm saying is bless the Lord because he's amazing. He's worthy of my praise, and it's giving him the highest praise when we say bless the Lord. And you'll find throughout the Psalms, you'll find areas where the blessed is used, whether it's blessing the Lord or praising God, or David will be writing and saying, bless these people, or he'll be telling the people to bless God or praise God. So the word blessed is throughout the Psalms. Now, what makes Psalms 103 a little different, and actually 104, it's the only spots where you find this, is it says, oh my soul, or my soul, and my inmost being. This is the only time David says this. It's the only time where he goes, this is so important That we can't just leave this to something verbal. We have to take this blessing to everything that is inside of me. Not a drop of me, whether it's physical in my flesh and bone or my soul, the most intimate part of who I am, that all needs to cry out to God and bless him, for he has done great things. And we see that it's only in Psalm 103 and Psalm 104 that we see that specific piece. And then we get this hymn, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name, for he has done great things." Psalms 103 is an absolutely phenomenal psalm. That hymn is completely inadequate. Because, see, he has done great things is an inadequate statement. Now, I can't get up here without sharing something that Zig Ziglar says. He often says when setting goals, you have to move from being a wandering generality to a meaningful specific. And when you look at Jewish culture, they are very specific on so many things. And this is where this hymn kind of leaves us hanging. See, we have to go and move from being that wandering generality to the meaningful specific in... a double slide there. Lois Verberg, in her book, Reading the Bible with Rabbi Jesus, says, "Christians can learn from the Jewish style of prayer that goes back to the time of Christ, that of blessing the Lord for every good thing. For a millennia, the tradition has been to pepper one's day with numerous short prayers of praise to God in response to each good thing we encounter around us." So what she's saying is the Hebrew and Jewish culture, the culture that David, King David, would have been raised in, the culture that Jesus and the disciples and Paul would have been raised in, was one where they spent time praising God for the minute things. So if you would see thunder and lightning, there would be a prayer that would follow that. You would acknowledge God in that moment when you see the beauty and the power of this. You might say, when you know, "Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, whose strength and power fill the world." Or maybe when you get dressed, you would say, "Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who clothes the naked." Or maybe we even take it down to just the absolute ridiculous. And when you peel an orange, or in my preference would be a clementine, and you say, "Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who gives a pleasant smell to fruit." See, in this Jewish culture that the scripture is written out of, in the context, you have to understand that they will take time and they will praise God and they will see the greatness of God in the most minute things. If you study, they have a significant number of prayers for so many significant and insignificant events. Because when you're spending your time seeking out things to praise God for, your joy level will go up. And so if we're looking to sustain our joy, the best way we can do that is to spend time praising God for the big and the little. Amen. So our praise needs to move from being that wandering generality to the meaningful specific of acknowledging God's greatness in the smallest things. When you see the sunset, you can praise God for his landscape. When you see the waves crashing on the shore, you can praise God for his power and his might, for the ability to hear that peaceful noise. When you walk into a building on a ridiculously hot day, you can praise God for the heat too. It's okay. But you can praise him for the gifts he gave those that invented air conditioning and gifted to maintain a building and keep it cool, that we get to enjoy as we move in and out of our cars, which we can praise God for. And she start going. He's heard Paul talk about, you know, praying without ceasing. He's talking about just finding places to praise God in and out throughout your day. And that's why that psalm, I say it's completely inadequate, because it says he has done great things. And it's so much more than just great things. See, Lois Terberg also followed up by saying, it's impossible to not feel a sense of awe and gratitude when you continually remind yourself of God's presence and loving care. When you feel God's awe and loving care, and you understand the sense of gratitude you have when you acknowledge God in each and every way, your joy will be sustained. Because whatever you're going for, you're finding God in it. And it's a reminder that he is there and has always been there and will always be there. And see, that's the exciting thing. And as we look at Psalms 103, and it comes up, and we see the part that we talked about, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. We actually read it, and David doesn't stop with there, and that's where the psalm or the hymn becomes inadequate, because the psalm heads down the right path, and it goes, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. And then he starts listing those benefits. And he says, who forgives all of our sins and heals all of your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for the oppressed. He has made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor does he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, and those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all heavenly hosts, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his work, everywhere is his domain. Praise the Lord, O my soul. That's a list that will bring you joy. So much more than he has done great things. So much more than just a simple, yeah, it's good. See, so often we our praise and our thankfulness to God is like my kids, where he does these amazing, exciting things in our life, big and little, and our answer is, yeah, it's good. Thanks. It was a good time. We can do that again. You know, we don't understand the journey of our life. We don't understand that sometimes in the desert where God redeems, he teaches us and he grows us, and that we can praise him for what he did even in the midst of our own stupidity. But we just look at highlights of things. We need to start enjoying the minute. Our praise needs to move from a wandering generality of thankfulness to the meaningful specific of actual gratitude. And then our joy will be complete. And maybe the most important thing about that type inside of here. Because it's fine inside a church service or watching online for you to say he has done great things. That works really well in a group of people who acknowledge that God does great things. And in our own personal lives, we understand what that means. Okay, but it's not enough. It's not enough to say God has done great things. We need to show the world the great things that God has done. Because they don't understand the statement. So if all you want to do is be a part of a group in a church and sit around and we sing our songs, then he has done great things is plenty. But if we want to go out and impact the 61% of Kalamazoo that doesn't have a relationship with God, that if you went through and said God does great things, they're going to go, great. But when you start saying this is what God has done in my life, let me tell you about a God that not only redeems my life from the pit, from the depths where you find your depression, your anxiety, your lack of hope, and your despair, the God that pulls me from that, but the God that's love expands further than the heavens, the God that regardless of what I have done in my life finds value and redeemability in my life, that he separates my sin as far as from the east as to the west from me. Let me tell you about this God that brings me so much hope and peace and comfort that my life can never be the same. Because see, when we start showing the great things that God does in our lives, and we don't just say he did great things, the world starts changing. Because they're going through the same stuff that you go through, except you're going through it differently because you have this hope inside you. And then when we start acting like it and start talking about it and start showing it, they start going, I don't know what's wrong with that guy, but I want to be like him. That's where the kingdom expands. That's where God can redeem the most. Is when we choose joy and we do that and we sustain that by praising God continually for the big and for the little and in detail. And we move it from being the wandering generality to the meaningful specific, because the world doesn't care about the great things that God has done until you show him how great your God is. So church, I got a few questions for you. And I'm sure these questions will not be some great surprise to you. But as I finish up my summer of God pulling me back to joy, and this isn't me speaking to you, this is me just sharing with you what God has been doing in my life from June, July, and August now, and where I am and how God is saying, okay, Rick, go out there and make a difference for the kingdom. I have to continually ask myself, because I'm not a bright person and I continually go back to old ways, so I have to ask, what is my joy founded on? What's the foundation of my joy? And I'm asking you that. Spend some time asking, and I know I asked that a few months ago, but is your joy founded on God? Because in Psalm 103, we heard, he is from everlasting to everlasting. That cannot be measured. And so if someone is there from the before there was time to beyond when time ends, I can affix my joy to him. And everything else will be okay. So church, what is the foundation of your joy? Second question is, do you understand God as your redeemer? Because we have this human nature that drives us to seek pleasure at times over seeking the joy that's found in following God's will, we find ourselves off course. And when we get off course, the self-doubt can build up. Remembering our past experiences can build up. And we have to maintain joy and to sustain joy, we have to remember that God is our Redeemer. Again, David wrote it again in Psalm 103. He redeemed my life from the pit, from the deepest depths. The worst that you can imagine. God has loved you to go there and meet you there and love you there and redeem your life from there. Do you remember to acknowledge God and understand God is your Redeemer? Then the last question. Are you ready to show the world the great things he has done? Because it's not enough to sing, he has done great things. Get your list. Spend some time today and just start going, okay, God, I want to start understanding the great things you have done. Get out a pen and a paper and start making your list. Spend some time in reflective prayer, calling out to God. Saying, bring to memory these great things, big and little. If you go to your car and it starts on the first crank, which hasn't always happened in my life, praise God. If you're going to go and spend some time with people, praise God for community. Praise God that we have the ability to meet together and we don't have to worry about being seen meeting together. We can tell whoever where we're going. Praise God. Find the little things, find the big things, and praise God. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, from the deepest depths of who I am. Praise his holy name. And show the world the great things he's done.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Sing, bless the Lord. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Your rich in love and slow to praise.
soul, oh, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Seemed like never before, oh my soul,
I worship your holy name.
That was challenging, wasn't it? The book of James, Jesus' brother, James wrote, he said, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. And I kind of feel like that was one of those messages that we walk away going, ah, that was good, that was challenging. Let's go to Wendy's for lunch. So here's what I want to do. I'm just going to give us 30 seconds to begin to think through and apply what we just heard. I love that prayer. Thank you, God, for the sweet smell of fruit. Right? And I get it. I love that. I love the smell of citrus. Love it. We got a bar of soap last year, and almost every time I would get in the shower, I would take that soap and immediately put it to my face because I love the smell of lemon. Thank you, God, for that smell. Thank you, God, that I see people here today that I haven't seen in a very long time. Thank you, God, for the opportunity to worship you in freedom. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. So what I'm just going to give us 30 seconds. Michael's just going to play in the background. And I'm going to ask you just to close your eyes, bow your head, and just begin to praise God. Praise God. I wrote down in my notes one of the things that Rick alluded to. And that's praising God for the minutia. For the little things, like the smell of fruit. So, enough of me talking. I'm just going to ask you to close your eyes. And for the next 30 seconds, begin to focus on thanking God. Blessing the Lord. Praising Him. For whatever it is he brings to your mind, just do that right now. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless and praise his holy name. Bless the Lord. And everybody said, amen. That was like 30 seconds. And I'm sure that there are a lot of you who were like, that was 30 seconds? That went by quick. Right. That's what we should be doing all day, every day. Is looking for those things to bless the Lord. So, one of the things, as Rick alluded to, that we bless the Lord for is air conditioning on a day when it was supposed to be 85 degrees heat index outside. Can I get an amen? All right. So, a couple things just for us to remember as we head into our week. Number one, you're going to see this card on the back table if you haven't picked one up already. This is about our upcoming sermon series that starts on September 12th out of the book of Acts. And we are asking you, for those of you who call Lighthouse home, that you would just simply begin to pray. That you would put this card, and you can even grab a couple of these cards and put them where you're going to see them. I believe, honestly believe, that this is going to be a life-transforming series in the book of Acts. I believe it with all my heart. I think God is going to do great things. Things that we are going to be talking about, hopefully maybe even for generations, but it starts with prayer. So I'm asking us as a church body to commit to the next 2 weeks to pray. And you can see, you could probably see it from where you're sitting. Pray is really big because prayer changes things. Michael put this card together for me. Nicole had it printed. I'm so thankful for Michael. But when he made it, it said 14 days to pray. And I texted you back. I'm like, it's got to be bigger than that. He's like, okay, how about this? 14 days to pray. I'm like, no, it's got to be bigger than that. Because that's how big prayer is, okay? So I hope that you will commit the next 14 days to pray. Pray about this series. Pray for me as we begin to process what God wants to teach us out of the book of Acts. Pray for open ears, open eyes, open hearts, and the unleashing of the Holy Spirit of God on our church. That's what we're praying for. So I hope you'll grab that card. Also want to just remind small group leaders that you will be meeting in the library as soon as we're done right here. Also, next week is the last week we're planning on being outside. Already looked at the forecast for next Sunday. It's supposed to be in the low 70s, which should be awesome. So unless you hear otherwise, we'll be outside. And then the last thing is this. In the next week or two, look for communication coming out about when we move back inside on September 12th. You guys, I love you. And I hope that you walk out of this place, not just blessing the Lord as you walk out that we got done in 51 minutes, but that you will look for opportunities today, this week, this year, the rest of your life for opportunities to bless the Lord even in the minutia. Can we just sing that chorus one more time? And we'll use that as our benediction, okay?
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Oh, I worship your holy name.
My friends, you are a blessing. Get out of here and be a blessing to the world you live in. Grab a card on the way out and start praying for that series in Acts. We'll see you next Sunday.